Okay, hello everyone, and welcome to our presentation on life extension of coke drums. This presentation is co-presented by Michael Trahan from Chevron Pascagoula Refinery. The presentation will be basically two parts. The first part is the part that describes the approach to this process of life extension, and the second part will talk about implementation experience. So the life extension approach that we developed over the years is based on four components. The first one is bulging assessment, and then cracking assessment, acoustic emission testing, and optimized data-driven repairs. And I'll go through them, those four, one at a time. The first part is bulging assessment. And the approach of bulging assessment is using plastic strains. This assessment approach is something that we developed based on about three decades of looking at coke drum failures and realizing that these cracks, the bulging induced cracks, they start due to excessive plastic strains. And plastic strain is a resultant of several different types of plastic strains. There is the plastic strain from the vertical curvature, from the circumferential curvature, from the change in length, the change in diameter, and the ovalization of a coke drum. All of those components contribute to the net plastic strain at any given point on the drum. To quantify the plastic strain, we developed the plastic strain index, which is the ratio of plastic strain that we calculate to the local failure limit by API 579. But most importantly, it's something that we calibrated using a database of bulge-induced failures over the last three decades. We have used this method, as you see at the in the table. We look at that ratio. If it's from 0 to 40, that's within design margin. From 40 to 60, it's within concern level. And then 60 to 80 is in danger. 80 to 100 is the failure range. These different levels are linked to the likelihood of bulging-induced cracks. And then we use those to make recommendations of the frequency of laser scanning, which is often performed with no basis. You know, do we do it every 3 years, every 2 years, 1 year? So this is a basis that we use for making that recommendation. So far, this method has been used more than 350 assessments. And so far we've had excellent correlation with bulging induced failures. This is an example of a PSI map, where this is a rollout of the coke drum. The x-axis is the azimuth, the y-axis is the height, and the z-axis is the PSI magnitude. And as you see, when you're looking at this in three dimensions, you will see the peak, the red peak, that is where bulging induced cracks will most likely develop. So it's a method that examines the entire drum and provide us an assessment at every point on that drum for bulging. We can use PSI values to trend drums to see how they change over time, both the maximum positive PSI and the maximum negative PSI, or the minimum negative PSI. And we can determine how a particular drum is deteriorating over time. We can also use PSI values to trend an entire set of drums. Like in this case, we're plotting all the drums in this one set over time, and we see how the bulging deterioration in that set is changing over time, and it's going from the design margin into concern and then into danger. This is the basis of the bulging assessment that we perform. That is the first pillar of our approach. The second pillar is cracking assessment. And this is a lot more difficult task because of the randomness and the complexity of loading in coke drums, which varies significantly from one point to another. In addition, when we're dealing with in-service material and as welded material like weld overlay repairs, the process becomes a lot more difficult. And what you see here is some of the testing that we have done on samples of both in-use material, material in-service material, and as welded weld overlay material. So we have developed a database of these results, and we use them to develop crack screening curves, as you see in this chart. So what we do is, for any given drum or set of drums with identical dimensions, we will develop a chart like this that will help us to screen for cracks. Basically, it helps us to prioritize repairs for any number of cracks that we may find during a turnaround. So in this case, what you're seeing here in this chart, it's a set of curves, each curve with a different color representing a crack length. And then when you look at the x-axis of the chart, that is the crack depth of that given crack, and the y-axis is the number of cycles to failure. So for every coke drum, we develop a set of charts like this that is specific to that particular drum for that diameter and that wall thickness. And there will be one chart for base metal and one chart for weld metal and heat affected zone. These charts allow us to calculate a conservative number of cycles to failure that we can use to prioritize repairs for those cracks. And we also have a utility, a software, if you would, that would help us implement these calculations to make it faster. So basically what we do is we list those cracks that we find. We determine the location first. Is it in the weld or in the base metal? We input the thickness of the wall at which the crack is located. And then we provide the length and depth of that crack. And this is an example of a set of 10 cracks with different lengths and depths at different thicknesses of the wall and at different locations, weld or base metal. And what we do is we calculate the number of cycles, and then we rank them automatically. We determine which one is ranked number 1, 2, 3, and 4, and so forth. With this process, we can determine which crack needs to be repaired or addressed first. That was the second pillar, which is crack assessment. The third pillar of our approach is the acoustic emission testing. The reason for acoustic emission testing is because quite often we look at the bulging side of the equation. We look at bulging severity, but we don't know what is going on about the cracks that develop due to something else other than bulging. For example, if we have a defect in a circumferential weld, or in a in other location, in a vertical weld, or in an attachment that is welded to the drum, if a crack develops in there and it starts to propagate over time, that crack can go through wall, and in which case we would need to know about it before we perform large-scale repairs. So the acoustic emission testing that we use is critical for identifying and locating active cracks in a drum. And I underscore active because acoustic emission testing does not identify, does not detect cracks that are passive. And that's why, and that's very important, because a crack, you know, because we may have 1,000 little anomalies and little defects that are not growing, that are no threat to the drum. We only really need to know about cracks that are growing, that are propagating. Once we know where those cracks are, not only do we correlate that with our bulging assessment, but we can add new locations that need to be addressed when we perform our long-term repair plan. So these were the, that was the third pillar, the acoustic emission testing, which is a non-destructive evaluation method. The last of the those four pillars is development of optimized data-driven repairs. And it's very important to underscore optimized and data-driven, because a lot of times I've seen over the years is, you know, sometimes people make decisions on where to repair and how to repair in a haphazard manner. And I have seen it time and again, is when you do that, it's like I always give the example of using chemotherapy. Chemotherapy is not something that you want to do, but it's something you have to do when you have to do it. And if you don't know how much you need to take in chemotherapy and when and what type, that can really cause more damage than good. So we take this very, very seriously to minimize the number of repairs needed. We want to use the minimum amount of repairs that are most optimal to address the problems that we see in the drum. And that's why it's data driven. We look at the PSI magnitude, we look at the rate of deterioration, we see the proximity to circumferential welds, we look at crack screening results, and then we look at inspection results. We take all that information to develop that optimized repair plan. Now, as most of you probably know, there are methods of long-term repairs we have been used in industry. One is window replacement, and then there is can replacement, and then there is weld overlays. Weld overlays are becoming the more popular approach and the most successful approach. And it, in many times, it's also most cost efficient. And they can be internal, external, or sandwich weld overlays. So to design an effective weld overlay, we need to look at the history of similar repairs. We need to look at the overlay thickness compared to base metal, how it terminates relative to bulge severity, whether we do sandwich layers or a single layer, whether we do it, which application surface do we put it on, the inside surface or the outside surface, and most importantly, how we transition that weld overlay, because that's where a lot of the problems are. If needed, sometimes we're asked to predict the amount of distortion that comes out of weld overlays, and that's where we can run our finite element analysis and come up with these color contour plots that tell us how much what that distortion is like and how many inches and what pattern that distortion looks like. Well, here's a recap of the life extension approach that I just described to you. So we'll have, these are the four pillars that we use for extending the life of coke drums: bulging assessment, cracking assessment, acoustic emission testing, and optimized data-driven repairs. With that, I come to the end of my part of the presentation, and I will hand it over to my co-presenter, Mike Trahan.
Thank you, Dr. Simon. How are y'all doing? I'm Michael Trahan. I'm representing Chevron, Pascagoula Refinery, Pascagoula, Mississippi. I'm going to be touching on a few things that that we've been able to adopt in our Coke Drum Life Extension Plan and approach here in Chevron. The four things I'm going to be touching on is really an overview of our current drum history to date, our critical step changes to focus of the drum reliability, the successes that we saw from actually executing structural weld overlay repairs, and our sustainable effort as we move forward in this process. So as you'll see here in Chevron Pascagoula, our plan originated in the early 80s. The Coke drums itself, we started with a 6-drum Coke drum operation, which is 3 modules. The current design then was a tapered wall design with a side feed inlet at a 24-hour cycle time. As we moved into later in the years of that drum in the 90s, we increased our cycle times, or I guess decreased our cycle times down to 18 hours, which in turn led to multiple failures based on the design that was there with the tapered wall. At that time, about the 20-year run, we decided from a project standpoint, we'd replace our drums with a newer design in 2003, which was the uniform wall with an uninsulated transition spool. That's a Chevron patented design. And then at that point in time, we actually decreased our hours even more to be competitive in the industry to 12 hours. As we moved into later in time, we actually endured some banana in effect that occurs with the drums. It's common with a carbon half moly type material. Basically, we actually patented an insulated transition spool with a bottom flange with actually the side feed inlet to the transition spool itself and not into the drum, which is what we have to date that I'll touch on a little bit in another slide. So as we got into around the more cycles of the 3500-ish time frame, we continued our inspection efforts to understand the damage and deformation of the drums that we know we face. At that point in time, we really didn't see much increase in deformation or bulging scenarios. We got better and smarter with industry, understanding quench rates to know that's a critical piece, a critical factor of keeping reliability of the drum. In 2015-16 timeframe, which is around that 4,500-ish cycle timeframe for our drums, we actually continued our inspection frequency and experienced significant deformation to the drums itself based on the results at that point. In turn, at that point is when we actually started working with the third party efforts, understanding what developments we needed to go towards and how we needed to manage our assets and develop some asset strategy. We actually, in the midst of all that, of trying to understand that, we actually had our first through wall failure crack at a drum in a high PSI area as data supported down the road. All modules were pretty comparable across the board, even with the area that we faced. With that, we led into a major turnaround, which was leading us into 2018's timeframe around the 5,500 cycles. Previous to the turnaround, a few months before, we actually encountered another through wall crack, which was in the same similar area of the crack we had before. Able to manage that and get ourselves into a position to where we can walk into the turnaround and go with the work scope that we developed from the asset strategy, utilizing PSI data and mapping out locations. At that point in time, we were able to basically go into the drum with physical data and the assessment piece to basically drive towards permanent repairs in the drums. We actually ended up doing about 4,000 square feet of overlay across all 6 drums, with actually utilizing Dr. Shimon's philosophy of, hey, managing cracks as needed, and not repairing everything, only utilizing the repairs that's needed at the locations that's there. This is just a kind of an overview of what our current drum is to date. It's the newer design at that point from the 03, the uniform wall. We had a larger diameter. We actually have a forged ring design across the board at all of our Chevron sites at the skirt location, which encounters its own difficulties, but that's another design that we have associated with the drums today. This is just to touch on a little bit of the banana effect that I mentioned. To date, we have, like I said, I mentioned a patented transition, insulated transition spool that we utilize at the bottom of the drum. Basically, it's a bolt up scenario at the bottom of the cone to the delta valve itself, with a side inlet feed to the transition spool itself to allow more of a center type feed design to that. As I mentioned before, on the previous drums we installed, and we were encountering significant banana effects that was occurring with our older design. And as we introduced the transition spool in this era, we've actually been able to sustain a manageable state with the drums now for 15 plus years to manage that banana effect and be able to continue to drill the drums. As you see, this is just a representation of the PSI data that we've been able to utilize with our current drums to date. This was previous to actually doing weld overlay. We were able to take this analysis and identify the highest strain locations that we were able to pinpoint our focus for inspection and potential repairs. As you'll see, that we had prioritized locations based on the analysis for us to be able to build work scope to basically go in and basically build our plan for future outages and what that was. In fact, this one was actually a pinpointed location in this area. We actually were able to actually pinpoint, this was the location where we actually endured our first through wall crack at this high PSI location, which is at the actual high priority zone area of A at this point. So as I talked about up top, so sustainable approach, how we go about this. So as we learned over time, we knew that we needed to basically come up with a plan inside of Chevron to basically allow ourselves to be better and not endure these loss containments, and how we can move forward with some kind of plan and achieve a drum life extension. So as we worked with Dr. Simon and industry data as well, we learned that we needed to be committed to something. We needed to get ourselves committed to doing something to get ourselves out of this large cost avoidance of replacing the drums every 15 to 20 years. So we adopted and went with the plastic strain analysis that basically we're utilizing today across our sites in Chevron. With this, we're able to basically detail our inspection strategies associated with each drum based on the data that we have, manage our maintenance activities as we move forward. We learned that as we went into 2018, it set us up for success and predictable outcomes in that outage. You'll see that in here, we were able to achieve a large amount of weld overlay scope in a manageable time inside of the time frame that we had planned. At that point in time, we were able to utilize, take advantage of the real-time inspection, the laser scan data, and the PSI data, and focus to get ourselves 100% crack-free at that point in time. You are able to utilize some of the things that Dr. Mack talks about around some tools that are available. We had the crack screening tool available in our toolbox for the potential that we were not able to basically achieve 100% crack free. We were able to prioritize the stuff as we were able to get data and utilize that to our advantage if needed. And we'll continue that effort as we move forward, because now with the known condition that we're in, as we continue our effort in 19, we continue later scans, and we're continuing to build work scope, as I'll mention later, as we move forward in 21, 22, and so on and so forth across module outages. So as I'm just going to show you a few pictures and just a few slides of really the process when we walked into that standpoint of the turnaround. So as a lot of you know, this is a common bulge. This is a bulge that we're seeing from the outside of a drum. So this is the actual physical data that Dr. Shimon mentions and talks about that is critical. So as we go in, you'll see these things. This is a basically weld area that we restored at our Inco with our 410, with our 410 cladding. Basically, we have our crack and indications at that location that drive potentially through wall. And as you'll see here, that we consider it as elephant skin crack and in your bulged areas outside of your weld locations. So to go back to the weld-induced cracking and bulge-induced cracking from my inspection. You'll see here that this is some external conditions that we actually mentioned. It goes back to inside and outside repair opportunities that you'll face. We faced both. Majority was internal, but we did face some external issues associated with welds externally, as you'll see here from the pictures that's there. And you'll understand the difference as the picture that we have from the inward and outward bulge where you need to focus attention on. So as we identified our inspection and was able to basically achieve our final work scope, we were able to develop a plan and work towards that, right? So in that effort, we were able to basically utilize some outside companies, third parties that were able to utilize the automated effort for automated welding to go in there and do the structural weld overlay. Basically, these are pictures of the process of itself, of basically setting that up and performing majority 360 type automated weld areas, the gouging effort of removing the cladding and doing the repair process of the actual application of the overlay. So as we completed that, and we did that across all three modules, we actually took a little additional initiative and attempted to try and do a baseline laser scan of one drum to basically give ourselves a feel good. Did we capture potentially what we attempted to do based on the analysis that we were able to do based on the physical inspection? And at this point, you'll see that we were able to basically get a laser scan, and before and after reflects the fact that we were able to minimize the PSI at that location and essentially tell ourselves confidently that the reinforcement at certain locations did help us to make a longer run with these drums. So as we walked out of 2018, we had to be able to come up with a plan to sustainably continue this approach and to keep our future plan and not having to replace drums at a shorter interval. And be able to extend the life. So component-wise, this is just an example of a component-wise of how we're managing our inspection strategy to be, you know, to predetermine what our inspection intervals are, what areas we're going after, and to basically minimize our effort and be predictable as we go into the future. So it goes back to the commitment that we talk about. We were able to get endorsement at our site to stay committed, to allow our plan to utilize opportunities when they're available to get inspection data to support our continuing effort to understand the deformation of the drum as time goes on. So this is just a representation. As we walked out of the turnaround, this blue line indicator was the previous structure weld overlay locations. It goes back to me indicating that we didn't attack all the locations. We attacked areas that we needed to at that time. So we knew we walked out of the turnaround in that effort of knowing that we had higher PSI locations that we can manage as long as we kept our process in place. So our leadership elected to continue that. We were able to continue to get inspection. And as the data supported it down the road, the higher locations that were still in play that we left were still there that we needed to continue our effort in managing that over time. So as you'll see with that result, we're able to basically come up with a plan now of what our scope looks like today. So as we walk out of a 2018 turnaround, we're looking at opportunities in 2021, 2022 to go back in and actually do more physical inspection based on the analysis that we have to basically potentially achieve more structural weld overlay and maintain the reliability of the drum, right? So maintaining that goes back to physical inspection. As you'll see, the top section is our external scope that we're driving to. which is essentially us going and basically inspecting externally to understand our condition of what internally is. This is the red indicates actually the weld overlay areas that we've already done of inspecting the transition locations, all the welds and the bulge locations that the PSI represents. Based on that external inspection, we'll work to the inside, and you'll see at this point in time, it goes back to our data supporting us that this is our minimum scope that we're going after. The blue lines indicate the higher concerned areas that we're going after based on PSI history and physical data in the past that we're going to go address at this point in time in a smaller outages in an individual module basis. So to utilize module basis versus bringing down the whole coke unit. So the key messages that we bring, that I'd like to bring to the table and working with Dr. Simon over time is really getting early development of this process or whatever process you utilize. Getting that detail out there and building that strategy plan to truly achieve long-term reliability of a coke drum. The key in our standpoint here in Pascagoula, and as we move towards some of the other sites as well, is getting the leadership and commitment on that side to work towards that and understand the philosophy and approach we're going after. Understood that the drum life extension is a really a preventive maintenance approach. At some point in time, things are going to get better as we see. We went in and did a larger amount of work scope up front based on the neglection that we had in our drums early on. And as we went in there and identified issues, we addressed them. The data today is supporting the fact that our scope should be minimal as time goes on, less than what we endured then. So, but in turn, you also need to continue to utilize industry and these forums to understand and learn what's out there as a tool as you continue your endeavor in the drum life extension plan. So that's all I had to kind of give Chevron. So we'll turn it over to questions and answers.